Travels of Ibn Battuta. In Indonesia. In the name of the compassionate and merciful God, praise be ascribed to God, the Lord of worlds, and the blessing of God be upon our Lord Muhammad, and upon all his posterity and companions. But to proceed, the poor and needy of the forgiveness of his bountiful Lord, Muhammad ibn Fat, Hali al-Bayuni states, that the following is what he extracted from the epitome of the Khatib Muhammad ibn Jazi al-Kalbal, upon whom be the mercy of God, from the travels of the theologian, Abu Abdullah Muhammad ibn Abdullah al-Adil of Tangiers, known by the surname of Ibn Battuta, FN, that he did not extract any. Sumatra. Green and blooming island. The greater part of its trees are the cocoa, the fawful, and the betel nut, cloves, the Indian aloe, the shaku, the baranzaki, bark, grapes, the sweet orange, and the camphor reed. The inhabitants traffic with pieces of tin and gold, not melted, but in the ore, as coin. They have not many rich perfumes. The more of these are to be found in the countries of the infidels, Hindus perhaps. Nor are there many in the Mohammedan countries. When we had arrived at the shores of this place, we put into the port, which is a small village, in which there are some houses, as well as magazines for the merchants, and from this the city of Arsuimatrif is at the distance of 4 miles. At that place resides the king. When we had got into port, the magistrate of the place wrote to the king, informing him of my arrival, who sent one of his nobles, and the judge who attended the presence, to meet me. With them was sent one of the king's own saddle horses for myself, and other horses for my companions. I mounted, therefore, and set out for Sumatra. The king, at that time, was El Malik El Zahir Jamaluddin, one of the most eminent and generous of princes, of the sect of Shafi'a, and the lover of the professors of Mohammedan law. The learned are admitted to his society, and hold free converse with him, while he proposes questions for their discussion. He is a great hero for the faith, and so humble, that he walks to his prayers on the Friday. He is too strong for his infidel neighbors, they therefore pay tribute to him. The inhabitants of his districts are of the sect of Shafi'a, and they attend the camphor is found only in the same places, if we except Japan. In another part of his work, Volume 2, p. 481, and see we find that no Mohammedan prince reigned in Java so early as the times of our traveler, and from the mention of Sumatra in our next paragraph, it seems race unable to conclude that the Java here mentioned must be Sumatra. A little farther on we have some account of Muljava, which must be the Java of our maps. See also the Histoire de Mongols, Torn. Note. Mr. Marsden tells us, Hist. Sumat, that the camphor is produced in Sumatra only. Him willingly on his warlike expeditions. When I came to his residence, his viceroy met me in an obliging manner, bringing with him dresses of honor, which he put upon me and upon my companions. They then brought us victuals, with the fafanut and betel leaf. After this, I returned to the lodgings which they had prepared for me in the garden, and had completely furnished with couches, and every necessary utensil. Morning and evening they brought us the tamarisk and other fruits from the vizier. On the third day, which was the Friday, they told me that the king was coming to the mosque, and that my first interview with him would be there. I accordingly went thither, and at last the sultan came. I saluted him. He then took me by the hand, and asked me of the King of India, and of my travels, and I answered him accordingly. After prayers he sat and discussed religious questions with the professors of divinity, being dressed as they were, until the evening. This is his and their usual practice, nor does he ever come to the mosque, except in the garb of a professor of divinity. When the evening is past, he enters a vestry in the mosque, and there changes his robes for those of royalty, with an upper garment of richly embroidered silk. He then rides to his residence. I remain partaking of his hospitality for 15 days, and then requested permission to pursue my journey to China, a thing which he is not always prepared to grant. He gave me permission, however, and fitted me out with provisions, fruit, and money. May God reward him. He also put me on board a junk bound for China. I then proceeded for 120 days through his dominions, after which we arrived at the city of Maljava, which is the first part of the territories of the infidels. The extent of these territories is that of 2 months' journey. In these is found almost every sort of perfume. They produce the aloe, the cacla, and the 5-camari, cacula and 6-camara being situated in these countries. But in the territories of Suwan Malik al-Zahir F. This is, no doubt, the Java of our maps. See notes to page 184. Mr. Crawford, in his History of the Indian Archipelago, volume IP 519, says, speaking of the lignum aloes, if it be a native of Tlai Indian Islands, the countries Java. In Java, there is only the frankincense of Java, camphor, some cloves, and Indian aloes. But we will now say what perfumes we ourselves witnessed in the territories both of the Muslims and the infidels. Of this is the frankincense, the tree of which is small, and about the height of a man. Its branches are like those of the artichoke. The leaves are small and thin, and the incense is a gum which is formed in the branches. More of this, however, is found in the territories of the Mohammedans than in those of the infidels. As to the camphor, its tree is agreed, like the asreed of our own countries, except only that it is thicker, and the knots are longer. The camphor is formed within it, and when the reed is broken, both camphor and myrrh are found within the knot, and of the same form with it, but the camphor will not form within the reed until some animal be sacrificed at the root. The best camphor is exceedingly cooling, and 1 dram of it will kill by bringing on suffocation. This is called with them the H card which produce it have not yet been ascertained. In Abu Zaidi Hassan's commentary on the two Arab travelers translated by Renaudot, this place is termed the country of Comer, from whence, it is said, they bring the wood aloes called Hud al-Comeri. Pinkerton's Voyages. I have some doubts whether this is correctly translated. The passage stands thus. It appears to me very probable that some mistaken account of the camphor reed, or tree, as it is here called, gave rise to Dr. Darwin's extravagant story of the Upas tree of Java. Avicenna thus describes it, p. 189, Losia JJ2T11, R.J, FDJB and C, of the camphor there are various sorts, the El-Kanchuri, the Riahi, in the next place the Azad, the Asphoric, and the Azraq. It is mixed with its wood, and is extracted by being sublimed. Some say that its tree is large, and will shade many men. The leopard is found near it. People do not go near it except at a certain time of the year. This is what some think. This tree grows in parts of China. Dr. Darwin tells us that criminals are employed to get the gum, and that they can get it only when the wind is in certain quarters. Now, if there is a superstitious belief that men must be sacrificed in order to produce the camphor, it is probable that criminals are selected for that purpose, and if the tree can be frequented only at certain times of the year, on account of the wild beasts, this may have furnished the other part of the story. But, as the Arabs say on occasions like this, Espang MJ, but God knows best. Dana, it is that, at the roots of which a man has been sacrificed. Young elephants, however, are sometimes sacrificed instead of a man. As to the Indian aloe, its tree resembles that of the oak, except only that its bark is thin. Its leaves are like those of the oak, but it has no fruit, nor does the tree grow large. Its roots are long and extended, and are scented within. The leaves and trunk, however, have no perfume within them. Among the Muslims this tree is considered property, but, among the infidels, the greatest part of it is not so considered. That which is private property is found at Kakula, and is the best sort. This they sell to the inhabitants of Java for clothing. Of the Camari species, some is soft enough to receive an impression like wax. With regard to the 180s, when one cuts off any of its roots and buries it in the earth for some months, none of its strength will be lost. This is the most wonderful property of it. As to the clove, it is a thick and high tree. It is found in greater numbers in the countries of the infidels than of the Muslims. It is not claimed as property, on account of its great abundance. That part of it which is taken into different countries is the mudan, wood. If what is called the flowers of the clove in our countries is that which drops from its blossom, and is like the blossom of the orange. The fruit of the clove is the nutmeg, which is known by scented nut. The bark which forms upon it is the nine mace. J. All that has here been related, I saw with my own eyes. F. It is said in a note in the margin of one of the Bas-Basil, of which our word mace is no doubt a corruption. Mr. Crawford describes the nutmeg tree as resembling that of the clove, volume IP 503, and hence, perhaps, our traveler has been mistaken. Appearing through the interstices of the mace, says Mr. Crawford, is the nutmeg, which is loosely enclosed in a thin shell of a black glossy appearance, not difficultly broken. From this place we went on to the port of Arkakula. It is a beautiful city surrounded with a stone wall of such a breadth that three elephants may walk abreast upon it. The first thing I saw upon its shores was the wood of the Indian aloe, placed upon the backs of elephants. This they lay up in their houses, just as we do firewood, except that it is cheaper among them. The merchants will purchase a whole elephant load of it for one cotton dress, which is, with these people, more precious than silk. Elephants are in very great abundance here, and are used for riding and burden. Each man ties his elephant to his door. The shopkeepers tie them to their shops, and in the evening they will ride out, purchase, and bring home, anything they may want, upon them. This is the custom of all the people of China and Escotum. The king of Muljavath is an infidel. I was introduced to him without his palace. He was then sitting on the bare ground, and his nobles were standing before him. His troops are presented before him on foot, no one in these parts having a horse except the king, for they ride on elephants generally. The king, on this occasion, called me to him, and I went. He then ordered a carpet to be spread for me to sit upon. I said to his interpreter, "How can I sit upon a carpet, while the Sultan sits upon the ground?" He answered, "This is his custom, and he practices it for the sake of humility, but you are a guest. And, besides, you come from a great prince. It is, therefore, right that you should be distinguished." I then sat, and he asked me about the King Jamaluddin, to which I gave suitable replies. He then said, "You are now my guest for 3 days. You may then return." I one day saw, in the assembly of this prince, a man with a knife in his hand, which he placed upon his own neck. He then made a long speech, not a word of which I could understand. He then firmly grasped the knife, and its sharpness and the force with which he urged it were such, that he severed his head from his body, and it fell on the ground. I was wonder. According to Mr. Crawford, China at this time affords one of the best markets for cotton in the world. F. It appears from Mr. Crawford's work, Volume 2, p. 481, and see that the reigning princes of Java must have been pagans at this time. A similar act is recorded by Mr. Crawford, but ascribed to a different cause. About 10 years ago, says he, the son of a chief of the province of Japan, possessed ing much at the circumstance, when the king said to me, "Does any among you do such a thing as this?" I answered, "I never saw one do so." He smiled, and said, "These our servants do so, out of their love to us." He then ordered the body to be taken up and burned. He next went out and poses as I unto the burning, in front of his prime minister, the rest of his nobles, his army, and the peasantry, and on this occasion he made provision for the family and relations of the deceased, whose memory is greatly honored in consequence of this act. One who had been present at the assembly told me that the speech he made was a declaration of his love to the Sultan, and that on this account he had killed himself, just as his father had done for the father of the present king, and his grandfather for the king's grandfather. I then returned, but was sent for by the king, to be his guest for the 3 days. After this I proceeded by sea, and after a voyage of 34 days, came into the calm, that is, the still, sea. It has a red appearance, which is thought to be occasioned by the lands near it. This sea has neither wind, wave, nor motion, notwithstanding its extent. It is on account of the calm state of this sea, that 3 other vessels are attached to each of the Chinese junks, by which these junks, together with their own cargoes, are carried forward by oars. Of these there are 20 large ones, which may be compared to the masts of ships. To each oar 30 men are appointed, and stand in 2 rows. By this means they draw the junks along, being connected by strong ropes like cables. This sea we passed in 37 days, which we did with the greatest with a belief of his own invulnerability, put the matter to the test, and drawing his cuirass, killed himself on the spot. The manuscripts have here, as well as in the former description given of these vessels. From the description here given of this sea, there can be no doubt that it received its name from the Arabian merchants. The still sea, for the same reason that Magellan called it the Pacific. What the island was at which our traveler touched, it is impossible to say with certainty. I suppose, however, it might have been that of the Celebes, as the distance and situation seems sufficiently to answer the time and description of his voyage. Of the word Tiles I can make nothing, because, as this seems to have been the name of the king then reigning, that name may have died with Herne. I leave it to others, however, to determine what place this is. Tawalisie. We then came to the country of Tawalisie, which is thus named after its king, as is also his whole country. It is extensive, and the king will oppose the emperor of China. He possesses a great number of junks, and with these he will fight the Chinese, until they offer conditions of peace. The people are all idolaters, handsome in appearance, and resembling the Turks. They are much inclined to a copper color. They have great bravery and strength. Their women ride on horseback, they excel in throwing the javelin, and will fight like men in battle. We put into one of their ports which is near Kailuka, one of their largest and most beautiful cities. The magistrate of this place is a daughter of the king Walardija. She sent for the persons who were in the ship, and entertained them, and when she was informed of my being there, she also sent for me. I went to her, and saw her upon the throne of government. Before her were her women with papers in their hands on the affairs of state, which they presented to her. She saluted and welcomed me in Turkish. She then called for ink and paper in my presence, and wrote with her own hand the H. Bismillah, and she read it to me. She then inquired about the countries I had seen, and of these I gave her suitable information. She said, "I wonder at the great wealth of India, but I must conquer it for myself." She then ordered me some dresses with money and provisions for my journey, and treated me with great politeness. I was told that in the army of this queen there is a regiment of women, who fight with her like men, that she made war upon a certain king, who was her enemy, and that, when her army was near being put to the rout, she made so furious an onset upon the king with her regiment, that she overcame him, put him to death, and routed his whole force. She then took possession of all he had, and brought the slaughtered king's head to her father, who accordingly gave her the government of these parts. The neighboring princes have made her offers of marriage, which he has refused to accept, except on one condition only, namely, that such person shall overcome her in the tournament. Of this, however, they have always been afraid, dreading the reproach of being vanquished by her. dreading the reproach of being vanquished by her, dreading the reproach of being vanquished by